Well, I think Dateline was the first program just to concentrate solely on television current affairs from other countries. And we've seen Foreign Correspondent emerge in the meantime, but Dateline was around, as we know, many years before that. And so it was a huge opportunity for me. It gave me the opportunity to become a Foreign Correspondent later, because I travelled through many countries, luckily for Dateline. And I'm sure it blooded a huge number of reporters like me over many years. And now, of course, it's evolved into the video journalists, the main sort of showcase for video journalists to travel around the world and do their thing. I was very lucky, actually, because I'd been working, I did one program at Four Corners at the ABC. I was trying to go from radio into television as a very young guy. And I did one Four Corners program and they said, oh, sorry, we don't really need you anymore. And then Dateline sprang to the rescue and offered me a full year of traveling around the world. So I went to 16 countries, I think, in the space of a year. It was a remarkable opportunity.
All through this part of the city, clothing factories with Dickensian working conditions.
The strangest thing for me is seeing this skinny guy with a mullet racing around in South Korea. So I was quite interested to have a look back at that story, and it reminded me of why we did it, because here was this this idea in Australia that Korea was doing these remarkable things, and we wondered how that could be the case. And we saw at the same time footage of horrible, incredible demonstrations between students and police, you know, these great confrontations, set pieces with tear gas and violence. And we wondered why all this was happening. And we set out to try and understand what was really going on in Korea. And we started getting reports of torture. And that's what we went to investigate. And we found that people who were trying to set up labour unions in South Korea were being attacked, arrested, tortured, interrogated, intimidated by the military, who had spies everywhere. We're in the middle of this slum area in South Korea, and there was a church, which was run by this right-wing organisation. We got trapped by these guys who were known to have savagely beaten some of the demonstrators with iron rods and poles, and we had to push our way out of this place, because as they were holding us inside this courtyard, we could see these other people pouring out of the neighbourhoods and carrying weapons, and we thought this is going to be very bad. And so we basically pushed our way through, pushed these guys out of the way and ran for it.
Good evening and welcome to Dateline. Tonight, a rare look at the opposition movement in South Korea. In Seoul, the artificial hothouse climate for foreign investment is cooling, encouraged by fresh waves of student unrest and the harassment, imprisonment and torture of labour leaders by South Korean police. Dateline's Tony Jones has been investigating the dark side of South Korea's economic miracle.
Some 100 police placing near my house. And police and the Korean CIA occupied some four or five houses, including next door house, to watch my house.
Many of the friends and the men and women that I worked with in South Korea had the marks on their body of their obedience to Christ and their commitment to social justice. They had been in and out of prisons and these purification camps.
The forms of torture they've used include water torture, which involves hanging the person upside down and pouring water into his or her nose, or electric tortures, or keeping people awake all day and all night, or the indiscriminate bashing of people.
On the first day of his capture, he was tortured twice for between 5 and 7 hours. It involved water torture, much battering, and pouring water mixed with chili powder down his throat. They also used electric torture on him some 10 times.
Government can do that anything, everything, if they want. It is our government. Our government is so powerful.
In South Korea, torture, imprisonment, and intimidation have become commonplace tools of power, part of the means by which opposition is suppressed. The authoritarian government of President Chun Doo-hwan maintains control through a bewildering legal framework. The national security law, the public security law, the anti-communist law, the law on assemblies and demonstrations, and the labor disputes law, to name but a few. Its internal security forces are among the most extensive and sophisticated in the world, and with the constantly stated justification of a communist threat from North Korea, the extent of their control and the range of their activities are profound. This is the dark side of Korea's economic miracle. It was the maintenance of ironclad stability under a succession of US-backed military dictators that made Korea such a fine place to invest. But now the optimism is beginning to wane.
The Korean economy has grown enormously in the last 20 years, from an agricultural economy to an industrial economy. But it's done that really with massive foreign loans, some foreign investment, and it's all geared to the world economy keeping on growing to allow Korean exports to expand and hence allow the Korean economy to pay back the enormous foreign debts. At the moment, the world economy isn't slowing down, so the Korean economy itself is in very serious trouble.
In 1988, this Olympic stadium will be full. The world's press will be here in force. Korea will be put under the microscope. For the democratic movement here, it's seen as a chance to gather momentum. They see 1988 as a deadline. But for his part, President Chun seems determined to crush his opposition before it has a chance to seriously embarrass him.
If we fail to realize democracy in 1988, no doubt our politics will be polarized into two sides. One is military dictatorship, extreme military dictatorship. The other will be radicalism. We, moderate Democrats, would lose our base because our people would become, extremely desperate. There is no other way to use violence, and no other way to accept radicalism. So that's why I have come back from America before too late. So I wanted to do my best effort to prevent that source of negative development of our politics.
A self-confessed moderate and admirer of the American political system, well-to-do and cultured, Kim Dae-jung is one of the two most powerful dissident figures in Korea. Earlier this year, when he made a dramatic return from exile in the United States, many feared that he would become this country's Benigno Aquino. Theoretically, the government could lock him up and throw away the key. Hanging over his head is a suspended sentence for sedition. But he's under constant surveillance and frequently house arrest, and he's banned from direct political activity. In spite of this, he and Kim Young-sam, the other key opposition figure, are the progenitors of the New Korea Democratic Party. Formed at the beginning of this year, the NKDP polled remarkably well in February's government-controlled elections. Kim Dae-jung, though, remains outside the party, exercising control through supporters in key posts. But it was a loosening of government restrictions that made these developments possible. And now, Kim says, the wheel has turned again.
Government has restarted its harsh crackdown of opposition movement since last summer. And they are now arbitrarily arresting students and laborers and human rights activists. Even they are practicing serious torture. And also they have taken harsher measure, even against National Assemblyman of Opposition Party. So as far as I know, government has now determined to crack down of opposition movement to threaten their, long-lasting taking power.
Among the younger and more radical members of the opposition movement, there's an almost religious commitment. 2 months ago, this student threatened to burn himself alive as a protest against the government. He decided rather to sacrifice himself in this way, grabbed by plainclothes security men while shouting anti-government slogans. For symbolic self-sacrifice is seen as a public demonstration of government oppression. Scenes as compelling as the self-immolation of Buddhist monks in Vietnam could well have emerged from South Korea in recent years had the international press been there at the time. For self-immolation as a symbolic act has its own horrifying tradition in Korea. On the 17th of September this year, a 27-year-old second-year law student, Song Kwang-young, set himself alight, crying out for an end to dictatorship. A few blurred photographs provide the only record of his action. Song died after lingering in hospital for more than a month. But Korea's most extraordinary suicide was the self-immolation in 1970 of a 22-year-old clothing worker from the slums of Seoul. His name was Jun Tae-il, and to the opposition movement, he's become a martyr.
As the Korean economy began to industrialise, as workers flooded in from the rural areas into cities such as Seoul and Busan, then there began to be real pressure to meet the real needs of workers, that you can understand. And this was thwarted in many ways by company thugs, by government pressure, simply by the difficulties of organising. But particularly in the early 70s, there was a struggle in the garment industry in Seoul, and one particular event catalysed the formation of a series of independent unions, namely the suicide of one worker, Jun Tae-il, who suicided deliberately to draw attention to the plight of garment workers who were appallingly paid and found it impossible to form a union.
For 15 years, Jun Tae-il's mother, Kim Nam-geun, has continued to fight for better working conditions in the clothing factories of Chonggae and for the independent union which the present government declared illegal in 1981. Like everyone else we spoke to in the workers' movement, she sees her son's death as a positive action.
I was working at home doing something else. And I later heard on the radio that Jun Tae-il had burnt himself, shouting out demands to change the labour conditions. He cried out demands that there should be a rest day and that working hours should be shortened and that people were suffering illnesses because of their work and should be looked after by a social welfare system, that workers were becoming weak and without life. The radio mentioned those cries and said that he'd poured gasoline on himself and set himself alight, holding up the book of basic labour laws and saying that this book doesn't give any help to workers and we have to burn this book.
Were people shocked by what he did?
While burning in the fire, he cried out not to waste my death and that this should be the beginning for changes in labour conditions. He said he had no friends among the university students. And listening to those cries, the student youth groups realised they did not have any real consciousness of the conditions of working people. And from that point on, the situation of workers and the labour movement became the focus of the whole resistance movement.
It was the beginning, too, of a fundamental role in the Korean workers' movement for the Christian church. The Reverend In Mung Jin, now living in Sydney, explains.
We did not know anything about such a working conditions, or terrible working conditions. So we shocked very much, we were shocked very much by the his commit suicide. We realized that how terrible the working condition of factory workers. I went to the John Taylor's factory. I looked around his factory at the time. 13 years old, 12 years old, women, small girl. I worked there. They worked for 12 hours, 18 hours, sometimes overnight. They were forced by the managers to work such a long time.
The church set up urban industrial missions at this time, and ministers took jobs in factories and began to organize labor.
Some of the Christians decided to live together with a factory worker. So we went to the factory. Some of our friends went to the slum area, lived together with factory workers, slum dwellers. That means we shared. We ate the factory workers together, and we laughed or cried with factory workers together. That means we shared our life with the factory workers.
All through this part of the city, clothing factories with Dickensian working conditions, many holding several thousand workers, honeycombed these old buildings. Workers in clothing sweatshops like these told us they were frequently compelled to work 14 to 16 hours a day, that their weekly day off was regularly cancelled. We were told that ill health is endemic because of the long hours and poor conditions, that in many factories people are refused jobs if they don't agree to sleep on the premises, that factory owners ignore the law and employ young children. The union established to protect these workers was declared illegal under martial law provisions in 1981. At the time, workers protested and there were a large number of arrests. Then we were told the government closed the union offices, took all the union documents, and surrounded the building with 600 combat police. That action signaled the move by the government to crush independent unions. The church was also targeted for its role in organizing workers. At the time, Tony Dawson was working at the Urban Industrial Mission in Seoul.
Any sign of dissent, especially within the church, it seems, was branded as subversive and as sort of pro-communist. Again, in 1982, when there was some labour strife, but also this year, whenever there are some demonstrations or there's a labour dispute, there's these lurid sort of specials on the television linking the Urban Industrial Mission and other sort of church sort of human rights groups with the notorious World Council of Churches and with a sort of a worldwide communist conspiracy.
The Christian church in Korea has long been a central force in the opposition movement, begging comparisons with Poland's Solidarity. This small service outside the local police station is a weekly symbolic protest by parishioners who claim that their church has been blockaded by government-paid thugs because of its involvement in the human rights movement. Reverend Park Hyung-kyu, himself a member of the World Council of Churches, has paid dearly for his advocacy of human rights, imprisoned five times in the 1970s. Under the present regime, he hasn't been jailed for his activities, but since 1983, he and the bulk of the congregation of the JL Church have been subjected to an extraordinary campaign of harassment and violence.
Every Sunday in the morning from 10:30 to 11, the hoodlums, those who use violence, comes and block our church gate. So our congregation couldn't get into. If we try to get into, they beat us. So that's why we used to have nearby our church gate. But even that service was disturbed by those hoodlums. So this is the safest place. They didn't come until here. So this is a nearby police station, so they didn't come. They didn't disturb our church service, so we used to. It's almost 1 year now, 10 months.
Who are these hoodlums you're talking about?
Well, part of them is former members. Former members who are now, they accuse me as a communist or a political pastor and so on. So those in the 70s supported me. A little wealthier families, they turned against me now. And they joined together with some outside people. Outside people, I suspected that they are connected with some agencies.
Some agencies of the government.
Some agency, military agency or some government agencies. I suspect, I have some confidence that the agencies sent these hoodlums. They are not Christians. They are ordinary citizens, seems, but sometimes seems that they are well-trained attackers.
Well-trained in fighting.
Yeah, in fighting, yes.
That same day, we visited the jailed church. With us were a Canadian pastor and a journalist from the same country. But clearly, we were not welcome. As we tried to leave the church, these two men blocked the only exit from the courtyard.
Sorry, I don't speak Korean. I don't speak English. You are speaking why you don't speak Korean?
I come to... The one with glasses is identifiable from photographs as a key instigator of violence against the church people.
Your name card. You have no?
You police?
I'm church. I'm Korean.
I think
I'm
it might
Korean.
Be an idea for us to leave.
You don't speak why don't speak
The Canadian pastor is attacked from behind while taking photographs. We decided to get out before the situation got completely out of hand. After a scuffle in which the pastor was assaulted and his film taken, we were able to get away. Why do they call you a communist?
Because I'm involved in human rights movement and movement for democratic democracy. And especially I'm engaged in so-called urban industrial mission. So anyone who supports the poor people's or laborers, those poor people's rights, if anyone who engages in that kind of movement, any pastors who engage in human rights or engage in those industrial mission, then you will be accused as a communist.
The one government official we were able to speak to in Korea, Mr. Kong Duk-soo, of the Labour Ministry, confirmed that impression.
A few years ago, we have the some you know the intervention from the other parts. For example, the you know the some sector of the Christian,
the Christian movement.
Yeah. But they are connected with the communist, socialist or the communist, the side of the, their tendency is like that.
In places like this, the opposition movement has made inroads by working for the urban poor. These slums in the industrial city of Incheon are built literally up to the back wall of a nearby factory. This man is typical of the inhabitants. He works 10 hours a day making bricks. His house is built from scraps of available materials. It has no toilet, no bathroom. He supports a wife and five children. Government plans to tear down these slums, though, have met with organised opposition. We were told that new apartments being built here will only house 120 of the 400 families affected. The remainder fear they'll be uprooted and set adrift. In such potential trouble spots, government agents are everywhere. In the heart of these slums, we were spotted and ordered out. Back at the car, we were questioned at length by uniformed and plain-clothes policemen who suggested we were trying to make contact with anti-government elements. The workplace in Korea has its own special dangers. This factory reputedly has Incheon's worst industrial accident record. We were told that amputated fingers and mangled hands are commonplace here. At a national level, Korea has one of the worst industrial accident records in the world.
Official figures for last year, I believe, were 157,000 injured or killed at work. But that only refers to those that are reported or insurance claims that are made. Of those, over 1,500 were fatalities, were killed. But the UIM feels that the sweatshops, the smaller places where figures are not kept, may mean that these figures have to be doubled.
The workers' movement attributes many of these accidents to long working hours. At this factory, we were told, people regularly work a 70-hour week. Overtime and night work are virtually compulsory. Yet when a group of workers attempted to form an independent labour union here last year, the government and factory owners worked hand in hand to prevent it. Some of the workers were sacked. There were allegations that others were detained and beaten by management, that others were offered bribes, and that police regularly arrested and interrogated anyone handing out leaflets near the factory. But what worries the government more than anything is the increasing involvement of the student movement in the workplace. This student agreed to speak to us only on condition that he remain anonymous.
At the moment, the situation is that workers' expression is repressed and the press is strictly controlled by the government. The student movements either expose the conditions of workers or demand political rights on their behalf through demonstrations and rallies. Students are also involved in direct participation in the workforce. They will go into the workforce and be involved in direct organization of workers.
The government has campaigned to root out the so-called fabricated workers. The key fear of the government is the coalescing of the church, the student movement, and the workers' movement, and the impact that could have at a political level.
Now, worker struggle now, at the moment, focus on political issues rather than economic issues. It is quite changed. Situation is quite changed. That means a workers' movement struggle became more ideological struggle rather than the economic issues.
The government has responded with a repressive backlash. The latest opposition document on the status of human rights in Korea alleges regular violations ranging from everyday intimidation of people in the streets to the suppression of judges and journalists, to torture during interrogation. Yeah. On the sixth floor of this building in Seoul, a small group of people have occupied the office of the Youth Association for Democracy. The organisation has been singled out by the government for special treatment. The group's leaders are either in jail or in hiding. These are their wives and families. They're here to protest against torture.
The former chairman of this organization was taken some time ago and severely tortured. Now he's in Seoul prison now, refusing to answer to the prosecutors. And in charge of violating the national security law.
The man referred to here is Kim Geun-tae, and he's been an active leader in the democratic movement. On September the 4th, at 5:30 a.m., he was picked up by the anti-communist investigating team of the National Police and charged 3 days later. His wife, In Jae-geun, knowing that he must eventually be brought to the public prosecutor's office, waited daily to see him. She finally did on the 26th of September.
I saw him when he was stepping out of the elevator on the fifth floor of the public prosecutor's building. And when I saw him there, he was not able to stand by himself.
Did he describe what had happened to him? Did he tell you what had been done to him?
On the first day of his capture, he was tortured twice for between 5 and 7 hours. It involved water torture, much battering, and pouring water mixed with chili powder down his throat. They also used electric torture on him some 10 times. They poured salt water down his throat, which they say helps the passage of electric currents through the body.
How did you feel when you saw him and when you spoke to him and he told you these things?
At the time, I was very confused and at a loss how to respond. I was unable to see many of the scars on his body because he was wearing clothes, but his big toes had been used to place the electrodes for the electric shocks, and he was able to show me this by taking off his shoes. Both of his big toes were blackened, and the top of his feet were scarred. Because he was so badly treated, and the kind of injuries he had suffered were so enormous, my heart filled with pain as if my chest was collapsing.
Was your husband still strong in spirit?
He was tortured twice on September the 4th, then on the 5th and 6th and 8th and 11th and 13th and 14th and 16th, some 10 times with water torture and electric shocks. And each time the torture would increase, would become harsher until he would collapse and his spirit would be attacked. But he also suffered from the fear of death. But he tried to overcome those fears and think of being human. In that way, his spirit was not broken, and that was what enabled me to cope with the situation.
Are any of these people communists?
Communists cannot come out in the open. No. They would hide. Or they would go into the government rather than come into this opposition movement. No. That's a natural thing.
So what do these people who've been arrested believe in?
Democracy.
Tony Jones reporting.